Welcome everyone. We have some really great practice for you in this video. Do you know why everybody's here in this world? Because they don't want to be anywhere else. That's why they're here. In fact, they don't want to be anywhere else so badly that they insist there is nowhere else. There is nowhere else, only this world, that's it. That just shows you how desperate we are to insist there's nowhere else. We just want to be here. We want to be in our hiding place. This is a great hiding place we have here. Hiding from what is the question? Hiding from truth. Hiding from God. Hiding from reality. That's what we're hiding from. Now, when people get to the end of their life, what do they? How do they feel? They feel relief. They say, "Ah, I've succeeded in what? What have they succeeded in? They've succeeded in not succeeding. They've succeeded in failing." And so they feel that failure is a great success. So what have they failed in? Well, they failed to resolve the continuity problem. They failed to let go of their projections. The ego is a projection. In fact, the term ego refers to all our projections, the totality of our projections. A projection is something that is we are causing, that we insist that it's, we're not causing, that the cause is outside of us. That's what's called a projection. And so we have all this, we live in the domain of our projections. And we think that the domain of our projections is God, that God is causing all of this. The fact is we're causing all of it. Our will, you see, the prime creator created spirit, us, what we are, the same as the prime creator, the same. The only difference is that the prime creator is primary. It's the beginning, that's the only difference. And the direction of creation goes in one direction from the prime creator through the spirit. So we have the same creative power as the prime creator. So we can create all of this, but it's a projection. We can project to an astonishing extent. Really, unlimited extent of we can just project, and we feel as if all of this stuff outside of this, our mind, we think it's outside of our mind, is got some exterior will. It's not our will, it's some other will. We call it, well, it's God's will. We say it's God's will. So we are totally accustomed, very accustomed to dwelling in this split mind state, as it were, of our little will here in this little body and this vast universe here with some other will that is inexorably pushing us around like pawns, you know, and we have no power over it whatsoever. There's some external will. Actually, it's all our own mind. It's all our own one mind. So we pass away here in this world saying, oh, very relieved that we have failed to recognize all of this, thinking that it would catapult us into a permanently different experience, very abruptly catapult us into this experience as permanent and totally different than we're used to. It's called the continuity problem. That is the continuity problem. So what is it that causes us to keep our projections as projections, and that we don't realize their projections, or if we do, we still bow to them and make idols of them? What is it that's causing all of this? The continuity problem is causing all of this. What is it that's holding it all in place? That's a better way to put it. What's holding it all in place so we don't set it down? The continuity problem is causing it. This is the trouble we have. All of the projections, the stuff the ego does to defend the projections and tell us that they're not projections and keep us deceived and deluded and insist that that truth and lies are both true, and that the ego can accommodate both truth and lies, and that they're compatible. The ego's position is that truth and lies are compatible in the ego. So the ego says, oh, they're compatible in my belief system. And said, that's superior to God because God is not tolerant. God rejects lies, whereas in the ego's belief system, they're compatible. Truth and lies are somehow compatible. And the ego says, it's come up with a new truth, greater than God's truth. A new truth in wherein both truth and lies are totally compatible. And so we, in the ego, tells us we're living in this superior reality to God's reality. God's reality is narrow-minded, is selfish, it's bigoted, it's intolerant of lies. You see, and the ego says, we're superior. So the people living here in this, in the realm of our, well, of our projections, we have the belief that we're living in a, not only are we superior to God, we're living in a superior existence, our experiencing is superior to God's creation reality. We really believe that. This is the marketing we give ourselves. But through projection, we don't realize we're just deceiving ourselves. This deception comes to us as if it were coming from outside, some outside source that is not us. That is how we keep ourselves bewildered and little and our will paralyzed. So the continuity problem is the only problem we actually have. Solve that one problem, and the infinite troublesomeness of projections will be dissolved altogether, gently dissolved and replaced with a vision of oneness. So it's like all our troubles will appear as if they were faint shadows. The same way that there are shadows when we move about the world here and the sun's out. And we see everything has shadows, right? Everything when the sun is shining has got shadows. But how often do we recognize those shadows? And do we go around saying, oh, look at this shadow. That is so amazing. Look at that shadow. No, we're looking at the objects that are casting the shadows. We're not looking at the shadows. In the same way, in the vision of oneness, all forms remain. But they're like shadows in that we're not paying attention to the surface appearance of all this form. We're paying attention to the one shared identity of everything, of the one identifying factor of everything, okay? Which is the total non-localizedness of everything, the total centeredness of everything, the total abidance in the heart of oneness of everything. We're paying attention to that in the superficial appearances of everything, the surface appearances. They're like shadows. We didn't pay no more attention to those than we pay attention to shadows that go about, we see and we walk about the world. But we can, of course, pay attention to them if need be. We can pay attention to shadows if we want to, sure. It's just that we're not interested in them, right? There's a great disinterest in shadows. So, here is a great practice that we're going to practice now. Because how do we move into resolving the continuity problem? Through right spiritual practice. Right spiritual practice. And it needs to be very spot on, extreme, very extreme, might call it. It has to be very focused properly. So the first thing we do is we make sure we're in the mood of repentance, it's called. Meaning, I have a severe, severe, severe continuity problem. It's the worst, it's the only problem I have, but it's incredibly severe. And I have to address this above all the other problems I have. Those things don't, you can't even compare to this one. And this one has to be addressed first. And it's very severe, and I know I may not have immediate success with it. So I need to really get working on it and spend a lot of time on it. The mood of repentance, very serious, very sober, very humble, very humble. Very quiet, very non-reactive. When you do have success, you just stay humble, say, okay, I'm experiencing some great breakthroughs and great success, okay, but I know this continuity problem is very severe, so I'm not going to count my chickens before they hatched, I'm just going to remain humble about it. Okay, mood of repentance. This opens the door to tremendous breakthroughs because you're not going to overreact to them. All right, so in the mood of repentance, non-reactive, non-emotive, calm, sober, you're not on the clock, you're just here, you're just present. You're just present, presentness. That's all, just presentness. Right here, right now, presentness. Sober, humble presentness. And now we're going to say, in this practice, this table as it is totally free of all surface specialness. This plant as it is totally free of all surface specialness. We can even use it with a simpler form. This plant is free of surface specialness. That's the simplest form. This walkway is free of surface specialness. Or we could say this walkway surface is free of all walkway surface specialness. Let's be even more exact. That stonework surfaceness is free of all stonework surface specialness. Okay, this is the basic practice. That rock surfaceness is free of all rock surface specialness. This bottle surfaceness is totally free of all bottle surfaceness specialness. Bottle surface speciousness. Specialness. This post surface, call this post surface. Post surfaceness. Surface of all this post. The whole post surfaceness. Or the surfaceness of this post, let's say the post surfaceness. This post surfaceness is totally free of all post surfaceness specialness. All right. This leaf surfaceness is totally free of all leaf surface specialness. This leaf surfaceness is totally free of all leaf surfaceness specialness. This rain surfaceness is totally free of all rain surfaceness specialness. This scenery surfaceness is totally free of all scenery surfaceness specialness. All of this surfaceness is totally free of all surface specialness. All surfaceness is totally free of all surfaceness specialness. All the surfaceness of this planet is totally free of all surfaceness, planet surfaceness specialness. All surfaceness of this planet is totally free of all planet surfaceness specialness. Planet surfaceness specialness. This metal surfaceness is totally free of all metal surfaceness specialness. So we're just introducing here a very powerful technique. I'm just kind of getting a feel for it, is all. Getting a feel for it. That driveway surface. You can do it this way too. You can do it different ways. We're not robots. We're not parrots here, right? That driveway surface is totally free of driveway surface specialness. Okay, this is even simpler. that walkway surface is totally free of all surface specialness. You can even reduce it to that. That road surface is totally free of all surface specialness. But to make it more specific, we say that roadway surface is totally free of all roadway surface specialness. We want the generalization to kind of take place more organically, so we got to include specifics here. We can include some greater generalizations, but make sure we include specifics. Otherwise, it won't generalize because it'll get hung up on some specific. Okay, that tree trunk surface is totally free of tree trunk surface specialness. That branch surface is totally free of all branch specialness. That branch surface is free of branch surface specialness. Okay, that's the simplest. That mat surface is free of mat surface specialness. That chair surface is free of chair surface specialness. That wall surface is free of wall surface specialness. Now you could do it even simpler. You could say that wall surface is free of specialness. That walkway surface is free of specialness. That tree trunk surface is free of specialness. That stonework surface is free of specialness. You could do it that way too. It's a more generalized way. So there are a lot of flavors. It's like an ice cream store. You can find a flavor that you like. This table surface is free of specialness. You could say this table surface is totally free of specialness. Or this table surface is totally free of all specialness. You could also say this table surface as it is free of specialness. This table surface as it is totally free of specialness. This table surface as it is totally free of all specialness. This table surface as it is totally free of all table surface specialness. Totally free of all table surface specialness. That's the souped up version, that's the hot rotted version. You can find something that's got traction for you, that you feel, wow, I just said something that's incredible. Yeah. That wall surface is free of specialness. That's a quick punch, you know, quick jab. Maybe that connects well. That driveway surface is free of specialness. That driveway surface as it is free of specialness. That wall as it is free of specialness. That plant as it is, that plant surface as it is free of specialness. That walkway surface as it is free of specialness. That hedge surface as it is free of specialness. Now when you have like a hedge and there's so much little leaves, just, you know, thousands and thousands, you might say that hedge surfaceness as it is free of specialness. Either way, permission for all surfaces, the surfaceness, all surfaceness of this universe, as it is totally free of all specialness. All universal surfaces. All universe surfaces. All universal surfaces. All universe surfaces as they are. All surfaces in the universe as they are totally free of all specialness. All surfaces in the universe as they are totally free of all specialness. All surfaces on this planet, all surfaces on this planet, as they are totally free of all specialness. All surfaces are specialness free. All surfaces are specialness free. All surfaces are free of specialness. So we're just warming up here, we're just warming up. Now you might say, well, I'm not getting any results. I'm not either. Okay, that doesn't matter. What we're doing here is we're gently breaking the barrier, okay? Gently breaking the barrier. We're kind of like stepping through a gate or an entranceway. We're kind of really careful about how we're doing it. So we're not really aware of what we're stepping into so much. We're more focused on just making sure that we get this done. But later on, the cumulative effect, one moment you will simply relax into the fact that you did it. And then there will be breakthroughs that come later. A lot of times in practicing, they're not the breakthroughs that you expect. Because you're struggling, you're trying to get used to this. This is a different way of using concepts, of like using language, a different focus, a different direction entirely. That wall surface. Because what are we seeing? We're seeing a surface, right? When we're perceiving, what are we seeing? We're seeing surfaces. Okay, so we're really directly getting to our perception here. That flower surface, as it is released from all specialness. There's another way of doing it. Okay. That table surface, as it is released from all specialness. That stone surface, as it is released from all stone surface specialness. That palm tree, as it is released from all palm tree surface specialness. That shrub, that bush there as it is totally released. That bush surfaceness, that bush surfaceness, as it is totally released from all bush surfaceness. It's kind of like you're dusting or cleaning the floor, and you're just so focused on cleaning up the floor, you don't see the room, really. And when you finally finish cleaning up, you're really intensely focused on it. You sit down, and you look around, and you see the whole room. You say, oh, wow, what a beautiful room that is. Wow. But as we're intensely working to clean it up, we don't notice it so much. That bottle surface, as it is released from specialness. That dirt surfaceness, that dirt surfaceness, as it is released from specialness. Now, what do we mean by specialness? Well, it means that everything that we're seeing, we're thinking it's outside of ourselves, and it has been put into some form by some will other than ours, and that we have no choice but to experience it as that form, that it's bound to that form. It is that form. That's what we're believing. That's not true. There is no thing identity. There's no identity to anything. There's only the one shared identity of everything. And so we're gently releasing the notion that we have no control over how we perceive. That the perception that we're used to is the only perception that there is. We're gently releasing this. This breeze surface, or the surface of this breeze is totally released. The surface of this breeze as it is totally released from all specialness. Or it stands free from specialness. It stands. Immaculately free. Perfectly free. Effortlessly free. It stands effortlessly free from specialness. This stone surface, as it is, stands perfectly free from specialness. Stands effortlessly free. Specialness. Dance perfectly and effortlessly free from specialness. That flower surfaceness. As it is effortlessly released from all specialness. Try to intellectualize what you're saying. Just know that your will and your spirit understands what you're saying. Absolutely, your spirit knows exactly what you're saying. But it's been in a coma for so long, and it's so afraid of the continuity problem. You know, it pretends that it's still sleepy, but it understands. It understands this. This is a language of spirit. Surface of that puddle is effortlessly released from all specialness. The surface of that rug, as it is, abides in effortless freedom from specialness. The surface of this table abides in effortless freedom from all specialists. The surface of this, the surface of this chair as it is, abides in effortless freedom from all chair specialness, from all chair surface specialness, or from all specialness. The surface of that pot as it is, effortlessly abides in surface specialness freedom, and freedom from surface specialness, and freedom from all surface specialness. Everything as it is, the surface of everything as it is, effortlessly abides in all surface specialness freedom. Effortlessly abides in freedom from all surface specialness. So we're just practicing here. We're not parrots here. We're just practicing. The surface of that noise, that rain gutter noise, the surface of that rain gutter noise, as it is effortlessly abiding in freedom from rain gutter noise specialness. So now we're getting a little more sophisticated. But it hits a little harder. You can't wiggle around that one very much, like, wow. The surfaceness of those pebbles, that pebble surfaceness, as it is, that pebble surfaceness, as it is, effortlessly abides in the very center of freedom from all pebble surfaceness specialness. So you see, when you start out simple, you get used to it, then you can start really focusing in even better. The surface of that ladder, as it is, effortlessly abides in the heart of freedom from ladder surface specialness. The surface of that raindrop noise, as it is, is the vast centeredness of freedom. This is the vast centeredness of total freedom from all raindrop noise specialness. Little chilly here. The surface of this chilliness, as it is, perfectly abides as the perfectly centered vastness of all freedom from chill surface specialness. surface of this wind noise, as it is free from all wind noise surface specialness. So we can go back to simpler forms. This plant surface is free of specialness. Back to the very simple form. This plant surface is free of all specialness. This flower surface is free of all specialness. This stone surface is free of all specialness. This day surface is free of all specialness. This hour surface is free of all specialness. This tiredness surface is free of all specialness. This computer surface is free of all specialness. All surfaces are free of specialness. All surfaces are free of specialness. All surfaces are free of specialness. Surfaces are free of specialness. All surfaces. This surface is free of specialness. That surface is free of specialness. All these surfaces are free of specialness. All surfaces are free of specialness. The surface of the universe is free of specialness. So wherever you look, you see freedom, right? You see freedom from specialness. Nothing is dead. Nothing is dead. There's only eternal life. Eternal life producing temporary decorations is one way to put it. Appearing as temporary decorationists, but that's another story. Now, it's vitally important to engage the spiritual path on the level of practice, like this practice. Even if you're not experiencing results. Like I said, I'm not really experiencing results. They're subtle, actually. You can see the results as I got better and better and better as I went along, able to include, you know, something more profound, more and more profound, more profound. And was able to add and subtract the various ways of saying it and became more flexible and all that. So you could see that type of success. And I was also feeling a sense of profoundness and some strain, some deep strain, like, wow, I'm really tackling a very challenging issue here of surfaceness, which is all we see is surfaces, right? We see surfaceness. So it's like very generalized practice, even though we're being specific, we're really talking about all that we see is surfaces. So there was progress, but it was subtle and easy to miss. But you have to have faith when there are those who tell you that practice is indispensable. You have to engage the path at the level of practice. Otherwise, the ego is too tricky for you. Too tricky for anyone. You won't make significant progress. You will make some progress, but not significant, not enough. Let's put it that way, not enough. However much progress you make, it's not going to be enough to try and clarify what's going on with the ego and how the craziness of the ego and seeing it. That's fine. That's helpful. But it's still of itself. It's not enough. It will never be enough. So if you really want to succeed, then you have to engage at the level of practice. And I find this practice is incredibly profound and brings about very rapid progress. I mean, just this afternoon, I was working some menial task, and I suddenly said, hey, why don't I just say, this surface has no specialness. This surface is free of all specialness. This surface, all these surfaces are free of all surface specialness. It just occurred. And then I suddenly realized, wow, this is an extremely potent spiritual practice. So just the very ability to entertain such a practice is a sign of huge progress, actually. Because this practice is super easy to generalize, because we can come to the realization that all we're seeing is surfaces, and that I have the capacity to set all surfaces free of surface specialness. All surfaces are free of all surface specialness, and all I'm seeing is surfaces. Easy generalization, rapid generalization, which could lead right into the vision of oneness. This particular practice makes a segue into vision of oneness very, very simple. We're only seeing surfaces, aren't we? And I've just said, this surface is free of all surface specialness. Meaning, I'm willing to see it that way. I'm willing to see it that way. I'm willing to see this surface free of all surface specialness. This post surface is free of all post surface specialness. That driveway surface is free of all specialness. That road surface is free of all specialness. That house surface is free of all specialness. That sky surface is free of all specialness. That sun surface is free of all specialness. That cloud surface is free of all specialness. That lawn surface is free of all specialness. That mountain surface is free of all specialness. All surfaces are free of specialness. All surfaces are free of specialness. So when we're engaging the spiritual path at this level, at the level of this kind of practice, for sure we are doing extremely profound spiritual practice. For sure we are part of responsible society. Those who are responsible. And for sure we're making rapid progress. And you can feel that this doesn't engage the ego at all. The ego's over in the corner with a dunce hat on, just staring at a wall, mumbling or something. It's got a dunce hat on. It's not really engaged in this at all, is it? No. So we get a break from the horrible, horrible argument with the ego that we're always undergoing of, like, you know, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, trying to weaken the ego, which is, again, just our own projection, a projection that we think has a separate will. So when we're arguing with the ego, we think the ego is a separate will from us, that is outside of us, our will, and we need to change the ego's decision to set us free, that the ego's will has to decide to set us free. That is not true. That is not true. That's why talking with the ego is futile. It's futile. Because the premise upon which that is based is faulty. It's mistaken. The ego is not a separate will. The ego is a projection of our own will. And only our own will can set projections down. At the level of causation, of choice, at the level of the projection effect, that a projection can't set itself down. It doesn't have any separate will. So as long as we're saying, hey, separate will, ego, you know, let us go, open your jaws, let us go, you must decide, let us go. We are reinforcing delusion. We're acting on a false premise, and it doesn't work. Now, the mood of repentance enables us to absorb the stupidity of what we've been trying to do. Ultimately, the futility of it. And of course, trying to do what is futile over and over and over again, we say is stupid. But what I would suggest is a better term for that, which is whimsical. We've really been engaged in whimsicality. And that takes the stigma of stupidity off us. I don't like the word stupid. I really don't. People freeze up at that. Because they start to realize, oh my gosh, I've been praying to idols, trying to get the idol, the will of the idol, to set me free. And that's, it was just my own projection. There is no will there. Oh my God, how stupid. You know, I'm just like, that's just so unbelievable. You're saying I'm really stupid. See, and then that they get panicky and angry and belligerent. It's whimsical. It's whimsical, and the whimsicality always throws out plausible rationalizations of why it's somehow not whimsy. Yeah, and that goes on forever. It never stops. It always has some idiotic rationalization that it thinks is really super smart. That's smarter than your reasoning. See, because again, our ego is saying that. We actually, it's projection, but saying that we are experiencing the compatibility of truth and lies, and this is superior to reality. So the ego thinks that whimsy is superior to reason, and that we are abiding in this experiencing, which is superior to experiencing reality. That's what it believes. That's the belief system that we have going for us. The projected belief system that we call the ego. It's futile to argue with whimsy. Completely futile. But here's the tricky part. Very tricky part. And believe me, I have fallen prey for this like everybody my whole life. We all fall prey to this. This whimsy, its goal is to entertain us in dialogue. As if it were possible to straighten it out. And so it gets us, pulls us into arguments and discussions with it, as if it was reasonable. And say, let's have a reasonable discussion here. You know, let's see if you can. And whimsy says, well, I can change my mind, you know, if you can show me. I'm very willing to change my mind. The ego says it's very willing to change its mind, change its will, change its decision, choice. If you can just explain to it, why is it changing its mind again? Now the trouble here is, it doesn't have any mind to change. It's a projection. It doesn't have any will to utilize. It's a projection. So you see the trick it's doing? It's saying, sure, I'm reasonable. I'm, in fact, I can even see the compatibility of lies and truth. I'm super reasonable, beyond reasonable. Whimsy says that it's actually a higher state than reason. It's beyond reason. And it says, yeah, I can change my mind. Just explain to me, why am I changing? The ego doesn't have a mind. The ego's a projection. The ego doesn't have a will. It's a projection. The ego can't change anything about what it is. It's a projection. Can a projection change the fact that it's a projection? It cannot. But the ego, again, says, well, I both can and I can't. I can. Those are both compatible positions. that I can do it, I can't do it. Same thing, the ego says. Totally compatible. Totally compatible. Again, utter whimsy. Utter whimsy. And of course, whimsy sees no problem with whimsy. Whimsy says, no, whimsy is perfectly, is superior to everything else. What else can whimsy say except that it's superior to anything else? It's totally superior. It's the prime creator. Total whimsy is God. That's what whimsy says, that whimsy is God. It has to say that. Or else you would just say you're nothing. It's nothing. Nothing at all. So it has to tell the big lie, right? That it's superior. It's the ultimate. It's the ultimate. So the ego has to believe it's the ultimate. So it says, I can do anything. You want me to change my mind about being the ultimate? Sure, just explain why I'm not the ultimate, and I'll change my will about that. I'll change what I am. No, no will, no mind, no capacity to change what it is whatsoever, no capacity to set itself down. Can projections set themselves down? Not at all. They're not in control of themselves. It's the one who's doing the projecting, that is the control, is the puppet in control of itself. Can the puppet move by itself? No, it's the puppeteer that is moving the puppet. Now, the puppeteer can have the puppet say all this stuff and say, wow, I'm independent, I'm separate, I can move my arm if I want to. Look at this, I'm going to say, I can move my arm, and out, boom, see, I moved my arm. You see, I did it on my own. The puppeteer is at me all the while projecting its voice onto the puppet and moving the arm in conjunction with its voice. And the onlookers are looking and say, oh my gosh, that puppet is moving by itself. Did you hear what it said? And then it said it's going to move, and it moves. Wow, that's amazing. Not realizing the puppeteer is projecting their voice on the puppet. Now, shifting gears again, because we're sort of luxuriating in our practice, catching our breath. I have reason. Now, this when we talk about world events, you can't really say reason. I have to say I have seen foreshadowing that could be interpreted. I'll put it this way: I've seen foreshadowing, gotten warnings and dreams, etc. A lot of different ways that tend to indicate that we are really in a certain time that is kind of the time that's been foretold. And I would say, I said that I had to be ready by President's Day 2014, which was just February 17th. I had to have confidence in spiritual practice, right? Spiritual practice that I could do it and I could share with others. I had to be at that point. All important, and I was exactly on that day. I reached that point, so it's right to the second, almost to the minute, almost, right there on that day. And then I had this indication, and it's been that there's going to be a month period from the 17th of February to the 17th of March, where we practice this right spiritual practice and get smooth it out and get confident about it. And then, on or about March 17th, something is going to happen. I call it the beatdown. What's going to happen is the mood of the world is going to shift. And it's going to shift into intolerance, which it sees as its salvation. The ego is going to pursue its plan of salvation in a very, very intense way. Now, today, I've gotten the overall impression this a mood of derision is going to be a mood of scorn and derision and belligerence. It's going to be like a psychological, verbal bullying of the world. Those who might be inclined to spiritual practice, they're going to be bullied and scorned and ridiculed, mocked. Okay, a period of mocking will last about 6 months through August, and then in September maybe around September 21st or something like that, there's going to be then some head knocking taking place. This is the time frame, sort of the general time frame that I'm seeing at this point. I can always modify it because it is very difficult to set exact time frames on the future. It is so fluid, but and then this overall situation is going to last at least three years, from March 17th. 2014, 15, 16, 17th, March 17th, 2017, is going to last at least 3 years of very, I call it a spiritual inquisition, spiritual genocide, an attempt to eradicate our tendency to go towards right spiritual practice, to our tendency to engage the spiritual path at the level of right spiritual practice. That is what the ego wants to eradicate. That is why it's been so difficult for me or for anyone to get to this point to be able to do this. It is very rare and difficult to get to this point. And it took me my whole life of effort to get to this point, and I made it only right at the last day. That's how difficult it was. Because this is what the ego is scared of more than anything, and this is what constitutes the fear of the continuity problem, is success, right? And so all our efforts are to avoid success, to avoid it. So we shy away from right spiritual practice, engaging at the level of right spiritual practice. We shy away from that, and we tend to side with the ego, in the ego telling us, how can we avoid that forever? How can we avoid that forever? It seems too scary. But those of you who are seeing these videos realize it's not too scary, is it? It's not too difficult, is it? So you know the ego's lying, as it always does. But because of our continuity problem, we don't realize there's a Holy Spirit, that God blessed us, and that blessing of Spirit is called the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is able to maintain all form, all perception in place for us. And it is like our pure will, our unprojected will, our will that is not projected at all. It's our pure will in a completely unprojected state, making sure that the continuity problem is gently resolved for us, making certain of it. So we don't have any worries about an abrupt awakening into reality, of knowing reality exactly as it is, permanently. We don't have any reason to fear that at all. The Holy Spirit will make sure that doesn't happen for us. That's its whole purpose, is to make sure the continuity problem is gently resolved through the vision of oneness. Through the vision of oneness. So that is there in our mind already. The Holy Spirit is a blessing upon Spirit. It is our Spirit. The will of the Holy Spirit is our will in a non-projected condition. The way it really is, right? Non-projected condition. So its will is our will. The will of the Holy Spirit is our will. It is our will, literally. It's our pure will, okay? Free of all whimsy. It's our will free of whimsy. That is the Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit is flawless, and will make sure that we do not suffer an extremely abrupt catapulting into a very alien experience that we feel is just completely different than what we're used to. It will make certain of that, that wherever we're at, there's a gentleness to it, okay? A smoothness and a gentleness to it. So there's no worries about the continuity issue. We only need to do the practices the Holy Spirit suggests. Only need to do those practices, and we will smoothly go into the vision of oneness. So the ego's attempt to bully us and intimidate us and terrorize us into avoiding right spiritual practice, avoiding engaging the spiritual path at the level of right spiritual And so the ego is going to try and to wipe it out here, you know, wipe that tendency out on this planet, the planet of renegades, the planet of pirates, the piratical planet of the fallen angels, the planet of the dark ones, the ones who want to hide forever in eternal death from God. They really are here, and they want to, again, wipe out engagement on the spiritual path at the level of right spiritual practice. Now, they've offered up substitutes, of course, lots of substitutes. They say, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? But what they really are aiming for is to soften everyone up in the world until to reach a point where they finally decide, you know what, we're just going to wipe all of that out. Let's just get rid of all spiritual practice altogether, really. But certainly, there's going to be an attitude of mockery first. I say 6 months of mockery. Now, there's already been a severe attitude of mockery building up in the world over the last 50 years, certainly the last 20, 15 for sure. It was very powerful the last 15. The internet and social media have disseminated this globally, this attitude of mockery. And so I say there's going to be 6 months of mockery, severe mockery, at the very least. There could be other more severe stuff taking place too, but on a spiritual level, attitude of severe mockery for 6 months. And after that, after having dehumanized, despiritualized everything that they're mocking, then they feel like, hey, it's better if we just get rid of them altogether, you know. That's not a big step for them, you know. They'll feel like they're able to take that step. And maybe the head-busting will begin. And this has all been foretold. This is the tribulation period of the end times. So this is a generalized time frame, and it seems to be going along this time frame. And there are others who also see this time frame. They have seen this time frame, and they're also saying, wow, a lot of stuff fits into this time frame. A lot of it fits. I'm not going to get into all of that eschatology, etc., symbology, etc. Not in this video, but There are those who are seeing that, yeah, this is a very probable time frame. What I say is, by September of this 2014, the situation is going to be seen to be terminal here. Terminal. Now, it is possible. For one thing, we think, because we want to fail, and we think this world's a great place of failure, we want to say this place is the world's only place there is, unless there might be some other place we might succeed, right? But the fact is, there are many, 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 many places, suitable places for us. So many, many, many. And there are those who are very aware of what's going on here in this world, from on high, okay? There's many from on high who have did the right spiritual practice, who have abided in the vision of oneness, who know, who have accepted reality as it is, who know exactly that right spiritual practice needs to take place, who knows the opposition to that, how it coalesces in certain places, who know that it's coalesced here on this planet, who know that they have a blueprint on how to try and wipe out right spiritual practice, and who know how far along it is, who know all this stuff, who know other places more suitable, more helpful. They know how to sidestep the whole situation. There are those on high who know all of this. And they can declare a refugee situation here. Okay? They can declare that there's a state of targeted conflict, unfair targeting taking place in the world. Persecution. There's a state of unjust persecution imminent. Okay, if there is an imminent situation of unjust, severe persecution, they can declare a state of emergency on this planet and declare a refugee, make available refugee status, make refugee status available to us on this planet, to literally go somewhere else. to literally go somewhere else and to take sanctuary in some other place. So when they see that there's imminent belligerence and unjust persecution about to take place on this planet, they can declare in a state of emergency on this planet, and they can grant, then they can declare that refugee status is available for those who wish to apply for refugee status, who wish to declare that they're claiming refugee status, that there's a sanctuary available now to go to. There's a sanctuary that is now available, and you can go to it now and avoid this unjust persecution that is going to take place here. So they can say the sanctuary is now open to accept refugees from this unjust persecution that is imminent. You don't need to wait until it actually starts. But it's going to start, I think, March 17th anyway, so we're just basically already there. So there can be, from on high, a declaration of emergency, of unjust persecution on this planet. An emergency declaration granting refugee status to this planet, to inhabitants of this planet, granting refugee status to all inhabitants of this planet who want to flee this unjust persecution and take sanctuary. That can happen. And I had it indicated to me it's going to happen. It may happen very soon. It may have already been announced, as a matter of fact. It may have already been announced from on high, and we're just, you know, we don't have the ears to hear it. But I picked it up. I picked up something. What? You know, I just felt like some refugee status has been granted all inhabitants of this planet. The availability of refugee status has been granted. You have to accept it. It can't be forced upon you. The option, the refugee option has been granted. The option of sanctuary has been granted to all inhabitants of this planet, to accept the status of refugees from unjust persecution and take sanctuary, all right? Now, when Jesus left this planet, they asked him, where are you going? Why are you leaving us? Where are you going? What's going on? He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. In my Father's mansion, there are many rooms. And if it weren't so, I would have told you. In other words, many, many places to dwell, he's saying to them, not just this planet. I'm going to prepare one of those places for you. Or not one, it could be a realm. I'm going to prepare a place for you. It could be a whole realm. So that at the end of the age, I will come back and I will take you to dwell in that place. Dwell with me in that place. And at that time, you will know the way. You will know the way, how it's going to happen, etc. And he'll come back at the end of the age. We're at the end of the age. We're at the point where this unjust persecution is about to take place. This spiritual genocide, the spiritual eugenic program, the spiritual holocaust is about to take place, targeting great spiritual practice on this planet. And Jesus promised he would come back and grant refugee status to those who wanted it, and that he has a sanctuary prepared to take us in. This is at least what Scripture is really talking about. Now, will this happen or not? We'll find out. That is for sure. We're about to find out. Now, Judeo-Christian tradition talks about this as the rapture. Okay? As the rapture. And, of course, this has been mocked, as the ego mocks everything. Because there are some aspects of it that may seem a little silly, but the principle is there. The principle should not be mocked at all. The principle is leaving this planet, fleeing from unjust persecution. That's the principle. Going to a sanctuary. That is the principle. And that's a very valid principle. Remember, the ego loves to tell us that this planet is the only place to live. Why? Because it has so much power here. Because it has so much belief here. Because we worship the idol of the ego so much here. The ego says, wow, this is a great hiding place. Everyone thinks that I have some separate will and I've got this power. Wow, I don't want them to leave me. I want to tell them this is the only place there is. Nowhere else to go. And if they could think there's nowhere else to go, they're trapped here, right? So, of course, the ego mocks this whole notion there's somewhere else to go. Mocks all of that. It mocks the ETs, that there's ETs. Why? Because if we realize there's ETs, they'll say, huh, there are other places, right? So the eagle says, nah, no ETs. This world's the only place there is. You're stuck here until death grinds you into the dust. You know, that's it. And Jesus said, look, if there weren't other places, I would have told you. So, okay? So there are many, 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 many rooms in my Father's mansion. Many, many, many rooms. Don't ever think otherwise. This is a direct gospel, okay? So, I mean, that's an option. There could be sanctuaries, places on this planet. Possible places, I don't know. That's possible too. But the overall essence of this idea is sanctuary from unjust persecution. Of course, all persecution is unjust, but this one is you know, it tends to be targeting something that is very precious. Because once the, you know, the ego gets its way and we get bullied, then it's very difficult, because you lose all sense of engaging the spiritual path at the level of where it's successful. And therefore you tend to feel futility in your spiritual path, and then you tend to give up. So you tend to give up, quit, and say, well, I'm not good enough, I can't do it. And then you tend to accept the ego telling you, well, the reason why you gave up was because you realized that this realm is superior. That here, truth and lies are compatible, and we're greater than God. And this is you like this realm better. And the ego tells you that, and then you really are messed up in your mind. Really, very confused. Now, we may think, well, those who have no right spiritual practice should stay here to give the example to the world. Well, the fact is that, for one, the persecution will be so intense that those who want to engage in right spiritual practice might decide not to. It's too intense, and they might flip, turn back to the ego. So we want to avoid that danger at all costs. Because all those who do go along with the ego, at some point, they're going to have such a problem. Their confusion will turn into desperate depression, and they will need then experts, highly qualified experts, super competent teachers to help them. You know, super competent teachers to help them. And so we have to become super competent teachers. That's our responsibility. Because once the pogrom is over and they just say, wow, I'm so confused, then they'll say, oh my God, help, 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 help. I'm really confused now. This is terrible. I made a big mistake. Then they will need super competent teachers who are not confused, or, you know, just totally clear and competent, super competent. And they will feel that super competence, and then they'll calm down and say, oh, good, good, good. We're not completely, we have not been completely cast aside. But right now, we are not super competent. I'm not a super competent at all. I'm only, my competency is in its infancy right now. Gotta grow up. It takes time to grow up to be super competent. But there will come a time, probably soon, when these highly, highly competent teachers will be necessary. You know, super competent teachers. The world, this realm of delusion will need, of self-deception, will need those teachers, a lot of them. It'll be very, very important. And that will help so many out of just this incredible feeling of being trapped, this horrible depression, which I've been through. And I can tell you, anything you can do to help those who are in that condition is very, very welcome and necessary. I got helped out of my situation because I came across super competent teachers. That's the only reason I got out of it. And I could feel their competency, you know, I could feel it. And so no matter how much I stumbled, I knew that they must be right. I know they're right, but I don't understand why they're right. But I know they're super competent, so I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. And that's super, super important. If you're not a super competent teacher, the present condition in this world is going to eat you alive. It's going to really eat you alive. Gobble you up. So, and there's a time when those who are having a temper tantrum and want to get rid of, you know, all right spiritual practice, where they don't want to engage in listen to you at all. They want to shut you up. So when the little kids having a temper tantrum, sometimes you need to step back. And if you try to stop them, they might injure themselves. You know, when they just let them, you know, work out their tantrum, and then once they're exhausted, and then they want to, you know, eat something, and they might calm down a little bit and realize that they temporarily lost their mind, you know, just like that. So, if, you know, let me put it this way, let the super competent teachers deal with the situation now. As it begins March 17th, as this mockery begins, as this tribulation period begins, let the super competent teachers deal with it, okay? They know what they're doing. If you're not super competent, get out, you know, sidestep it. Get out of harm's way. Let the super competent ones do it. They may come into this world or not. I don't know what they're going to do, but they know what they're going to do, so let them do what they're going to do. We don't need to tell them what to do. We don't even need to know what they're going to do. There are super competent teachers, believe me. I know at least four of them. And I'm sure there are many, 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 many more. So they know what they're doing. Holy Spirit knows what it's doing. So we don't need to worry about that. It's not an issue for us. We just need to do what we're supposed to do. We're infants. We got to protect the infants from Herod's pogrom. You know, Herod said, kill all the infants, right? Kill all those whose spiritual practice is in its infancy, right? Before Jesus gets a hold of them. That's what Herod was really saying. Let's make sure that there's nobody, no right spiritual practice here. Ostensibly, they said he's trying to get rid of Jesus, well, that too, but really, it was aiming at, let's get rid of all those who are in their infancy in right spiritual practice, because Jesus will, you know, educate them, and they will grow into fruition, and the ego will be no more, because the ego is just a projection that thinks it's not a projection. So the ego's terrified. He says, if you do this, I will be annihilated. Now, the ego won't be annihilated because it isn't anything in the first place. How can you annihilate nothing? How can you annihilate a projection? You don't annihilate a projection. A projection is just the belief that it's possible to split our will. It's not possible. So it's like the rope was never a snake. We don't annihilate the snake. We just realize it was never there. That's what happens. We just realize the ego was never there, ultimately. So nothing gets annihilated. There's no annihilation of the ego. Now, the rope was never a snake. So the snake didn't get annihilated somehow. We just realized we were hallucinating. That's it. So March 17th is coming soon. It's 17 days away. 2.5 weeks away at this point. Now, I just went and checked the area that I had in the dream that showed me this specific area when it said when the blossoms are on the trees and the grass is starting to grow in that spot, you can know that the turnover times are very near. They're going to be here. I just went and checked it today. Blossoms are on the trees now. They are there. They weren't there before. All the trees, the blossoms are now coming out. Another couple weeks, everything will be in totally full blossom, okay? Totally full. So, according to that dream, now exactly what happens, I'm trying to understand, because I was shown something in the dream about what's going to happen. But I can tell you that the time of happening is here. It's going to be here in the next 17 days, and likely by the 17th, something will be going on now. Something will be going on. You'll feel, uh-oh. Here it comes. This isn't good. You'll say, this is not good. The newspapers, local newspapers, newspaper. I'll spare them the embarrassment of naming them, but that. It's amazing, the articles now, front page, everything is on a central theme. Like it's taking orders from central bureaucracy, from the Politburo. It's really like, it's just like, wow. They're like head, you know, head, the, Using a sledgehammer. They're trying to sledgehammer you. The newspaper. Right on cue. It's just like, wow. They gave up any pretense, you know. I mean, they're propaganda. You know, they're an organ of propaganda. For sure. It's part of this beatdown. And I've talked about the beatdown. It targets certain demographics, you know, primarily. As it gets started, war is getting started, you know, they have certain focus, and they target certain things, and then gradually it spreads and spreads and spreads and spreads and spreads. So you can see that they're at a specific target now, and they're honing in on that target relentlessly. In the newspaper, and I'm sure it's happening all over the place. I'm not paying any attention to it on a large scale, because I'm paying attention to right spiritual practice. But pragmatically, we need to be aware that this is going on. And don't engage with it. Then you're going to lose. Right spiritual practice is what you have to do at this time. But again, we're not stupid either, right? We're aware that here it comes. Here comes the tsunami. Who wants to be mocked? Who wants to be derided? Jesus said, if you speak the truth in this world, you will be mocked and derided. Well, sure, but who wants to be? I don't want to be. I spent my whole life in hiding from derision and mockery and feeling completely alienated and isolated, because I was mocked when I was young, for sure. And it's horrible. It's horrible. It's not a sign of honor or badge. I mean, Jesus, it makes it seem as if, like, you know, well, he says, look, that's the price you pay for following the truth in this world. But it's not a price I want to keep on paying. No way. No way. It's useless. It's a delay. It doesn't help me. It doesn't help them. It doesn't help anyone. But, I mean, there's a certain, when the mockery gets to a certain level, you can kind of realize, hey, you know what? Maybe it's a good time to get out of Dodge. The whole thing of, like, trying to hide everything you do, like living in the catacombs, and you can't let anybody know what you think or really believe. You have to lead a false life. Your whole life is a life of a false persona, false front, laughing and smiling at what they say and joking, yeah, I'm just one of the guys. It's one of the egomaniacs of this world. Yeah, sure. Having to completely suppress and repress all your reactions, all attempts to help people, all this has been my life. Horrible life, horrible existence. Living in the catacombs. So I don't have any interest in continuing to live in the catacombs. I want to get out of here, sidestep this tsunami, this beatdown of mockery. Because it only gets worse. It only gets worse. Goes into martyrdom then. I have no interest in martyrdom. I really don't. My whole life, I've been a martyr my whole life already. And it doesn't hold any appeal to me or value to me. Once you see right spiritual practice, that's all you want to do. That's all you want to do. You don't want to say, look, by my guilt, my blood is on your hands. Look how wrong you are. Look what you've done. You know, who wants to do that? That's childish drama kind of stuff. I'm not into that. I don't want to project guilt onto people, and I know what their problems are. That's no way to go about solving it from my standpoint. So I'm not into martyrdom at all, not into mockery, not into martyrdom. And it's gone far enough. I mean, what I'm seeing, the level of intolerance on this planet is just so whimsically driven that it's, and so whimsically rationalized, so magically supported by the ego's magic. You know, the ego thinks it can solve all problems. Wow, through magical thinking, magical belief. I call it the logical plausibility. It's really just whimsy, trying to pretend that it's not. I have no interest in that. I have And I have no interest in trying to be a hero, trying to reach those who are, you know, engaged in this, try to shame them or something. That doesn't work. They have to engage in right spiritual practice. And right now, they're in a temper tantrum. You gotta just wait until they cool off and they can be a little more rational and you can, you know, speak to them and they can at least recognize your competency, you know. They at least can say, there's gotta be a better way. And then they ask for a better way and then they become aware of competency. That's what happened to me for sure. Became aware of the Holy Spirit and I said, wow, there's some kind of perfect competency here that I was unaware of before. Yeah, that's what happens. So, and then the Holy Spirit introduces some of its teachers to me, you know, and I say, wow, they really got the job done. They're super, super competent, no question about it. So I say, and the Holy Spirit says, you can do it too. I say, I believe you. I'm seeing it. That's what I'm about. I'm not about martyrdom, okay? I don't want to lead anybody into martyrdom. It's not what I'm about. Right spiritual practice. Just keep on doing it. Take sanctuary. Claim refugee status. Take sanctuary. Right spiritual practice. It's easy. We'll keep doing it here. I'm just trying to show you how easy it is. It's not a big deal. You can do it. You can do it. And say, I don't have a mockery problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have any mockery problem. I only have a continuity problem. Therefore, I'm going to put all my efforts into focusing on solving that continuity problem. The vision of oneness resolves it. I'm going to place all my efforts of right spiritual practice towards accepting the vision of oneness. That's all I need to do. Very simple. I lead a very simple life. Very simple life. That's all that we need to do. All right. Very great. Thanks for watching. And I'll get this one uploaded onto YouTube. That's it.